All aboard! Board! All aboard for Riverside! Chester Depot, Bartonsville, and Rutland.
What have we got pulling us here? What's the motive power on this train?
Number 15, former Tennessee and Oneida Railroad, consolidation type engine used in freight service down there in the mountains.
How did it get all the way from Oneida, Tennessee, up to the Rutland track?
Well, she was sold to the Rahway Valley some 20 years ago. And they used it for a number of years, and then she was replaced by a diesel in 1955. And I bought it in 1956, and I've had it since then.
Made originally for mountain work and short runs?
She was made for trips about over 50 miles in duration in mountainous country. The wheels aren't as high as a passenger engine would have, but she's got a lot of pulling power for her size.
What type locomotive do you call it?
Well, it has eight drivers and two lead sets, a 280 consolidation type of car. It was a very adaptable engine. They used them. The boss in the main used to use them particularly in milk trains. They used to be able to pull a lot of milk cars and make them go like the Dickens. Meanwhile, they went through Meredith, in New Hampshire there, 65, 70 miles an hour at night with the milk, you know, and they were very adaptable engines. Back when I was a young man, and they used to take care of them those days. They don't do that now.
Oh, you speak of when you were a young man. When did you start railroading?
Well, I used to bail out in the Dixon and Harrison Railroad up in Dixon, Maine, and also the Sandy River and Rangeley Lakes Railroad back in 1934, 35, through to about 1938, when things just about was all over then. Ellis Atwood bought the railroad in 1940. 41 and moved it down to Eaterville, and now I own the Eaterville Railroad, so it's kind of an interesting thing. I started my career out up in Maine and now own the equipment down in Massachusetts.
Well, back to number 15 is a beautiful pounding engine. What pressure do you operate at?
She runs at 200 pounds. She tops at 200 pounds, maybe 200 to 2 pounds, but we don't run her over 190 because we hate to waste the steam.
You certainly enjoy wasting it on that whistle. Where did you get that whistle?
Well, what makes you think we're wasting it? That's really beautiful music. The whistle came off the 6039, which is a Grand Trunk Western mountain locomotive, mountain type. That's a 482. And she's a big, heavy, high-speed express passenger locomotive built for heavy-duty service. And we bought the engine up in St. Albans, Vermont, from the Central Vermont Railroad, right after she came out of the shop in 1957. And we tried all the various whistles that we had off these engines, and on the 15 we have three whistles. We have a Boston and Maine Railroad whistle off one of the 3600s, and the one that you hear in this record is the 6039. And then we also have a British peanut whistle that comes off one of the air passenger engines, and I blow that occasionally, but most of the Americans don't like to hear that peanut whistle.
What are you going to do about this roadbed? Are you going to bring new tracks and straighten them out?
Well, the track is in very good condition. It used to be the main line from Boston to Montreal, and it's not what you'd call a branch line railroad. It's a main line railroad. We've got heavy iron, and that's why you can, if you hear those sounds, we can get up to 60 miles an hour on this track very safely. There's no problem.
Well, the sounds here on this record is if you're going about 160 miles an hour.
Well, so that you could really hear the stack music, I dropped the Johnson Bop way down in the corner, and I had her pulled right out. Of course, the grade up there, where I was going up through there, is about 1.5%. And we got a good start, and we were really rolling and went by you.
A lot of people who listen to this aren't even going to know what a Johnson Bar is.
Well, the Johnson Bar is the lever that reverses the wall-shot valve gear, which changes the direction of the locomotive, the wheels, whether it pushes forward or backwards. And just like an automobile, when you put it in reverse gear, because there's no gears. All it is just change the motion on your valves, on your locomotive, and emit steam, push the piston out of the way. It's a device that's rather complicated. Look at it, you see all these rods and levers and things and eccentrics around the wheel area and coming out of the piston across them. it's an involved thing, but the picturesque thing, I think this is one of the things that makes the steam locomotive so colorful, to see those wheels and rods flipping around and hear the sounds and smell the exhaust, all the things that go with it. I don't think the steam locomotive can be beaten, nostalgia in any way. I've been an airplane pilot for 21 years, and I love airplanes, but I don't hold a candle to one of the best passenger.
How I miss the music of the whistle and the bell, and the breathing of the air pump, more than any tongue can tell. The 280 consolidation brings those happy memories back, as it roars defiance to usurpers of the track.
Chester Depot, Bartonsville, and Rutland. Riverside, Bellows Falls, and Way Station.
Thank you.